a landlocked ship, where our soldiers are training in the important job of stevedoring, the USS Dixie. King posts, booms, winches, hawsers, all the equipment necessary for dock training of stevedore soldiers. Here they are preparing to raise the ship-sized booms of their mock ship. And up she goes, the hatch boom swinging into position, or as they say in ship language, being topped. It's up, and a soldier longshoreman makes it fast by securing the bull chain. The loading crew swings into action, and longshoremen remove the hatch covers, under which lies the hold where cargo would be stored. The covers are quickly piled in neat stacks on what would be the aft deck of a ship. It's an important job, the unloading of our ships at debarkation points. Because of this, the Dixie and other land ships like it are being used by the quartermaster stevedore battalions for training with the same equipment and procedures used by seagoing ships. The gangwayman directs the winchmen from the deck, each hand indicating one of the two winches. And in the hold, longshoremen are attaching the sling to the platform on which the cargo lies. Pallets is the nautical term for these wooden platforms. Rope sling for the sling carrying it away. And fall for the cable supporting the sling and pallet. On shipboard, these heavy winches would be puffing steam, but steam is unavailable. And instead, compressed air is used to turn the winch heads. Out of the hold swings the cargo load as the gangwayman directs the winchman as to its course. The outboard or deck boom swings it over the side and lowers the cargo onto the dock. Here, cargo hauling trucks called forklifters pick it up and clear the dock for the next load. They're training for speed in unloading, so our convoys may operate more efficiently to and from distant ports of military call. Keep them sailing, Army stevedores. Pigeon headquarters. Barracks for the Signal Corps' feathered messenger soldiers, smallest members of our army. Sleek and well-fed pigeons, busy raising families of more flying messengers for use by troops in the field. A PG portable loft, a mobile housing unit for army pigeons, which travels with the troops up to the theaters of operations. The soldier is carrying the smaller tactical PG-60, employed for carrying the homing birds into combat areas. Constant reconnaissance of shifting enemy positions is vital in today's swift-moving warfare of position. But reconnaissance activities are useful only when reported. Sometimes radios cannot be carried. Sometimes they can't be used because they give away positions of the sender to the enemy. It's then that Private Pigeon becomes valuable. Message books and map overlays are kept inside the carriers along with feed for the birds. Extra light paper so it won't be too heavy in flight. The message folds to fit into a capsule, which is fastened by a snap to the bird's leg. Off into the skies. The worst weather will seldom stop the pigeon's straight, swift flight to his loft. And here he comes, back home. From the the pigeon's leg comes the strategic message to be telephoned quickly to the command post. The wings of Private Pigeon, U.S. Army, have carried out an important communications operation for the Army. Parachutists of our Army, training for physical fitness in the hard days to come. Steady balance learned from narrow catwalks, ladders, horizontal bars. A gymnast jungle. Toughened muscles getting tougher through daily workout. Constant exercise to help these paratroopers in the strenuous action they expect. Ground landing practice. A trolley snaps them to the earth so they can practice the acrobat's way of falling when they land. Forward, head down, weight on the shoulders. Fewer broken bones or bruises this way, and it's good preparation for the real thing. Mass jumping from a plane 2,000 feet up. Out they go. Down to earth, the toughened body and trained falling technique invaluable in landing. That's it. Good work, soldier. Chemical warfare officers are host at Edgewood Arsenal to distinguished military visitors from 16 American republics. The party starts on a tour of inspection of one of the many chemical plants. The visitors try on the Army service gas mask. And in the technical building of research and development, the Latin American officers are told about dust masks and other protective equipment. Following their tour of plants and buildings, the inspecting party leaves for field demonstrations of chemical warfare activity. Functions of the flamethrower are demonstrated to the visitors to help them understand the chemical warfare weapon in action. Then, explanation of the magnesium bomb, dropped in clusters to make its incendiary action more widespread. The phosphorus hand grenade. It has a threefold combat use, as a smoke bomb, a fire bomb, and for inflicting burn casualties on the enemy upon exploding. A colonel from the Cuban Army throws a phosphorus grenade. Brilliant phosphorus smoke. The delayed explosion and intense heat. Last, a demonstration of chemical warfare from the air. Planes flash by the visitors, laying dense smoke screens, following with a barrage of 100-pound phosphorus bombs. And 16 Latin America good neighbors learn the value of a potent weapon for victory. ¶¶